for you guys. So again, the model that we were fitting was intercept, baseline log viral load, slope over time, and then the interaction between baseline log viral load and slope over time. So maybe pay attention a little bit to these median posterior SDR, medians of the posteriors for each of those parameters that I've got there. And if we go back and we kind of say, all right, now let's compare that with the frequentist mixed effects models. See that the MLEs in these cases are about -45.78 compared to -44.97. That's matching up well. Month -0.592, month -0.5.57. So should hopefully have seen fairly similar results, assuming that you put roughly or quite a few priors at least on the parameter estimates there. Okay. As you're going through. Again, I would argue one of the nice things about the Bayes procedure, we're getting roughly the same results from the non-informative priors there, but one of the nice things is on the posterior estimates for the individual slopes, for example, we can obtain basically posterior draws all the way across kind of the fixed effects as well as the random effects, so that's kind of a nice thing. So you're kind of front circling both of those, so I tend to like that aspect here. But when it comes down to the actual point estimates on those things, right? You guys hopefully saw something roughly like that, right? So this is my, let me get a little bit smaller though. Empirical Bayes on the bottom, so this is the frequentist estimate here from the MLEs. This is the Bayes posterior estimate. So those things aren't very, really at all in terms of point estimates. It's just in terms of the uncertainty that you're seeing on those things. And you know, I mean, that's the kind of the sanity check you have, particularly in a linear model where things should keep much. If you're non-informative on these things, they should be roughly similar to one another. Okay. Part of the reason why, you know, from just a point prediction perspective, if I'm doing kind of linear mixed effects modeling for individuals, I just put frequency model. Otherwise, we come right back to the same results, but with the hassles of trying to deal with the tuning, things coming up on the sensory, things like that, right? I mean, with the frequency mixed effects model, it's LME. So I tend to become fairly pragmatic in terms of model fitting in those cases. Again, if I was really trying to give uncertainty on an individual, and I'd like to try and account for that uncertainty as best as possible, then I might go more Bayes and think about, again, uncertainty across the random effect as well as the Bayes effect. Okay. All right. And these were just some of my slope estimates for individuals that I had there. And again, what you've got is the independent OLS estimates. I mean, the kind of the key take-home message here is if you think about the independent estimates, those aren't borrowing any information off of individuals. And I don't know if you can make it out, but there are actually two dotted lines there. One is the frequentist and one is the Bayes, and you'd expect those to be matching up pretty well, just given the plots that I showed you from before. Sometimes an individual is kind of falling right along with what's going on in the population. That's what's happening with this individual here, right? So there's no shrinkage that's really going on that person. They're just kind of, they look like the average. Whereas the person I have over here on the left definitely does not look like the average. And in fact, they're going up, right? I mean, you don't expect to be seeing that in their CD4 counts. So you definitely, you're an independent OLS estimate looks like this. Borrowing off the population, you're going to attenuate down a little bit. It's not forcing them to be negative necessarily, but you're attenuating them down. Okay? Because you're saying, look, just about everybody else in the population tends to be going down. What's going on with this person? You can kind of see there's some craziness going on here, right, in terms of what's happening with this individual. So you might not want to be trusting just their individual level of OLS estimates. Good. Anything else to mention here? No, nothing right now. Other questions about that, though? Yeah.
Like that individual over there?
Yeah.
Not like them. So I just wanted to make sure that that's the reason.
That's the exact same reason, right? I mean, because the rest of the population marginally, again, this is a good representation of what the marginal population, this person has very little treatment. Those two lines that are sitting right there, this is roughly aggressive for what's going on with the CD4 counseling. So on average, when you're looking across people, that's kind of what's happening across folks. And so that's exactly what was happening in your case as well. Good. Intuitively, though, just out of curiosity, intuitively, which model do you prefer? For the frequency model, intuitively, yeah. Anybody differ? I mean, I don't think there's right or wrong answer to this. I mean, I actually tend to intuitively prefer the frequency model, too, but I think that's partly because I was kind of classically trained early on to think about it and understand it that way. But I can also see the opposite side of this and say, yeah, you know, this hierarchical structure, right, I can think about this top theta, and I kind of calm down, and each individual has their own parameter, and I'm putting the distribution on each one of these. That's pretty intuitive as well. So I can kind of see both arguments of this. Maximum likelihood estimation in general is not super intuitive at first, I would argue, right? Kind of taking this PDF and maximizing it. Like, have you guys ever thought about really what's going on there? I mean, we kind of throw words on it, like, yeah, you know, you want to find the parameter estimate that maximizes the likelihood of your observed data. Well, okay, but you're kind of flipping things as you're doing that, right? As you're doing that estimation. It's not obvious, I would say, at my first game. When you guys are done with, you know, qualifying exams and things like that, start to think philosophically about what's going on with some of these things, right? Okay, so you guys have, wait for it, your final homework assignment. Potentially your final Gillen assignment of all time, kind of dumb problem. Potentially. So, you guys are going to do a couple of things for me. So in class today, I'm going to do something that's analogous to what you had done already on homework for the linear model setting, and that is I'm going to look at the efficiency of fitting a GEE model where you've got a misspecified variance covariance matrix to see how much of the efficiency we lose if we're wrong in terms of our weight. Okay? So I'm going to kind of set things up for you so everything should be pretty well packaged, and then you're going to kind of extend that simulation study in problem one of your homework, your very last homework assignment. You're going to look at a couple of things. So I'm going to do it in the balanced and complete data setting, and then you guys are going to look at it in the incomplete data setting, where you're going to remove some observations. And then you're also going to, I'm going to look today at an exchangeable correlation matrix being the truth. You guys are going to look at an AR1 structure being the truth and see if there's any differences there. So, you know, the underlying idea of what I want you to look at is to say, well, suppose that our data really has an AR1 process. And by the way, I'm sitting up here, I'm in a logistic regression setting, right? So I've got a binary response to what I'm talking about. So suppose the data really has an AR1 type process, but you say, I never took Gillen's 212 class, I'm just going to go ahead and throw an independent GLM at it. So how much efficiency do you actually lose there? Okay, and then you're going to consider that same structure where you then remove some of the data and then see what happens there. Notice on each one of these things, I'm seeing things like legal correlations. That's because we have bounds on the correlations for binary responses. Again, I'm going to quote them in my lecture today for you guys, but it's this Fréchet inequality, right? So you can't really have correlations of 0.9, 0.8 for binary data. Okay. It's bounded between usually somewhere around 0.05 and 0.04. Very good. Depends upon what the underlying problem is. And then finally, the last problem of the homework, the second problem, is going to be an application of a GEE model. This time, it's actually going to be, though, for count data. So, but hopefully, I'm not going to show you any examples of analyzing count data in class. I'm going to show you an example where I go through everything for binary response data in a case study. But hopefully by this point you realize that in your thinking about a GLM type of setting, it's just a switch of the link and it's a switch of the variance function. That's really what you got to be thinking about. Okay, so you should be kind of old hats now at applying the type of generalized linear model and then bringing that into account for binary count or you're gonna do some EDA for me on the variance covariance structure. You're gonna fit some GEE models based upon what you've observed. And then the last one, I want you guys to go to town for this a little bit. I want you to look at delta betas in that case, okay? And then there is no function to do this, so, but delta beta is pretty straightforward, right? What is it? It says take out the ith observation, refit the model, see how things change, okay? And then hold on to those differences between your parameter estimates. So that's what I want you to do there. And again, the idea there is to look at influence. You know, all of those things that I covered back in 2011 where you're looking at influential statistics and things like that, model form, functional form, all of that still applies. Okay? It doesn't go away now that we're in the correlated data setting. So pop quiz, how do you look at functional form? And PLM. Thank you. Partial residual, all right. So what you're going to look at is basically it's the first order Taylor expansion. It's the linearized form, right? It looks like y minus mu, t mu d beta, plus, and then add on the contribution for that jth covariance with this coefficient corresponding. So you plot that against what? In general, you want to be thinking about the whole subject, but you can also think about what is the impact of any single observation, right? So most of the time, you are thinking about the odd individual in the population, and that really is thinking about what the fixed effects are doing. But then if you're thinking about changes, for example, in a random effect on somebody, you might want to think about the individual level observations, and if you will, do delta empirical base, right, on each one of those. So if I pulled out one of your observations, how much does that change your little b estimate, right, as I go through? So again, you want to think population level, how does each individual cluster contribute to those things, and what is their influence? And then at the individual level, how do each of my individual observations contribute to my individual thing? That makes sense? All right. So, now in this case, of course, you're fitting what kind of a model to GEE models. We would call that a, starts with an M, so what I'm looking for, a marginal model, right, grand system. So there is no conditional random effects here, so really you are thinking about the populations. Other questions? In case I forget, I have homeworks 2 and 3 up here for when you guys leave, by the way, so grab those. Or 3 and 4. 5 and 6 will hopefully be coming very, very soon. Okay. Alrighty, so let's go back then to lecture 12. Finish this guy up. Again, I'm kind of moving pretty quickly through this, but I'll argue that I'm moving fairly quickly through this because it's really the same things that we've seen. The only difference now is that I'm taking that PLM framework, I'm thinking about the variance covariance matrix of the response, and I'm just decomposing it now and saying, I'm going to assume some correlation structure between observations on the same cluster, but then I've got this concept of a mean variance relationship occurring down the diagonal. That I've got to account for in that discrete response. So similar to what we've had before. So that's why I'm moving fairly quickly through this, but if there are questions, then please stop me. But I will argue that these are quite natural extensions of what we've seen in the past. So last time we talked about, again, I just recap some of the classic dependent structures one might assume by doing EDA, right, on a property. Okay, then, again, the concept here, and we discussed this last time, is to just think about an estimating function that has our little classical form of u beta, the inverse y minus mu, and everything now is, again, is a matrix on the individual level, because I've got multivariate, I've got a vector response on scale here on my individual. But this is exactly the estimating function that would come from the store for an exponential family model, where again, we would assume some sort of a leash function that's going to define what D is here, and we would assume some variance covariance matrix in the invariance relationships at the top, okay? So the correlation structure as well as the invariance relationship. And again, I noted last time that we treat this as a semi-parametric model because the only two moments of the distribution that I'm specifying here are the variance and then the mean, okay? And there's nothing else going on there. And the confusing part, and I understand the confusion here, is you guys say, but yeah, but that comes from assuming an exponential family where you have this full likelihood. The idea is to derive it down and use it, but then don't necessarily trust it. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, hopefully you're getting that trick now. And I tried to justify last time, really go down back in the 60s, justify the use of it, even if you were quote unquote wrong. I mean, he kind of said, look, if I take any arbitrary weight here, call that AI, and hit it by Y minus mu, which is an unbiased estimation function, then the optimal weight that I can choose is that guy. Okay? So, by his optimality criteria, which kind of makes sense in terms of efficiency. Okay. So there is an aspect of foundational pinnings for looking at this particular form of the estimating function. Okay. All right. So again, the properties of this guy, the nice things are it's an unbiased estimating equation. Once we set that thing equal to zero and solve for beta, so that means beta hat is going to be a consistent estimate for beta. That goes back to our good old Huber-White result. Again, if I specify this guy correctly up here, then I will have correct variance estimates just coming out of the second derivative of the log likelihood again, so I'd be right back in the exponential family. Seven. And then finally, if I'm approximately correct, and this is again what we're going to look at a little bit today, and you guys are going to look at on the homework, then beta has to be a more efficient estimator. Again, it goes all back down to, in this case, iteratively reweighted least squares, because you've got to get the mean as well, right? As well as the office. Okay. And I do notice this, right? When the difference here from what I've had before is now I have a beta inside of that B. You guys with me? So when I was talking about the general linear model before, I just had an alpha. That's because I wasn't assuming that the variance was tied to the mean. Right? You guys with me on that? Now though that we're in this kind of discrete data cases, for example, that variance up there is going to be a function of the mean, which is parameterized by beta, as well as these alphas, which are kind of your quote-unquote correlation parameters. Okay. So it's a function of both of those guys. So the fourth one is kind of the big kahuna, if you will. It says, well, if you're going to do inference on these marginal parameters, then what's their asymptotic distribution? And the proof of this, exactly analogous to what you guys did on the midterm, actually, so the Huber-White result. Okay, so it's, again, first-order Taylor expansion of the score evaluated at the solving estimator, so beta hat. Okay, so that thing is equal to zero, expanded out, and then you can get a handle on that thing because the score is nothing more than a sum, so you apply the central limit theorem, and in particular, the Lindbergh-Feller central limit theorem. Okay, so that guy to get asymptotic normality. And what you see on the variance is exactly what we've had before. I'm calling it IM here. That's the model-based variance. That would really be the Fisher information inverse that you would have if you'd specify the likelihood correctly. So that guy is sandwiching in. Inside here, I've got the average of the expected value of UU transpose. Oh, well, that's nothing more than the limit of the average of the variances of the estimating function. Those are the true variances of the estimating function, right? Good. So you can write this down. Well, the average of these guys, that's just the variance of u, because u has mean zero in this case. So if you take the variance of your Gödel estimating function that's sitting up here, you're going to get a D transpose V inverse on the left. In the middle, you're going to have the true variance covariance relationship for Y. Then you get a V inverse D on the right. Okay, you take the transpose of that guy to the right. So again, this should look very, very similar to us because it's exactly what you guys were doing in the GLM univariate case as well as in the linear models case. The linear model case is kind of nice because this D becomes what? You got an identity link. It's D mu D beta, so it just becomes X, right? The design matrix. There's no transformation on anything that's sitting there. Okay. So you back what you had on the midterm was just an X transpose D, B star, V inverse, and then X on the right. Okay. So this is kind of nice then. So let me just kind of say this here. So in this case, again, we've got this sandwich looking estimator that looks like an A inverse B A inverse like we had before. And lo and behold, if you specify that variance model correctly, your variance covariance structure correctly, if you like basically win the lottery, and you specify this correctly, then you're going to get that the covariance of Y is equal to, not that, but the covariance of Y is equal to V, the thing that you assumed in the estimating function. So these two guys are going to cancel out, and at the end of the day, you'll get a D transpose V inverse D. Oh, that's exactly that initial information coming back, so that means that H just reduces down. So same thing again that we had seen before. So, if you're wrong though, we know that this is going to be the truth. We know that the expectation of UU transpose is not going to be the Fisher information. And so we're not going to get cancellation. And so that means that we've got to do something about that. We know we've got this interior piece to the sandwich. So what are we going to use for the interior piece of the sandwich? Well, we know it looks like the variance of Y. So what I'll do is I'll take the moment estimator for Y. Take the residual, times residual transpose. Again, this is everything we've been seeing in the univariate case, continuous multivariate case, now the multivariate discrete case. Okay? So again, folks will typically call this the robust or empirical sandwich estimator. Okay? As you go through the literature. All right. And the nice thing here is that again, this is a consistent estimator. The consistency depends upon capital N. That's really an incomplete statement though, because if little n is growing at the same rate as capital N, I'm going to have some problems there as well, right? Or if it's even growing at a faster rate. You guys with me on that? Little n is the number of observations I have on each individual cluster, right? So it's going to be the dimension of this matrix that's sitting up here. And so what happens is if your number of observations are increasing faster than your number of independent clusters, when you start taking the average of these things, that's not going to work out so well for you. The number of parameters is going to be growing faster than the number of observations that's going to be.
Yeah. People just throw away data.
No, they don't throw away data. You know, it's rare in longitudinal settings that you would have that setting. You'd have that situation. Again, most longitudinal data would be lots of independent clusters, few kind of measurements on each independent cluster. I mean, usually my setting is like, I'd like to have more information, you know, the type of work that I would do on the individual clusters. Now, if you're Monticello back there, she works in time series data where she's really dealing with like few clusters and then lots of measurements on each cluster. Well, in that case, this isn't going to help you. Okay, so what do you got? Yeah, you can do individual nonlinear regression, but you still got to account for the variance and covariance structure, right? So estimate variances on your parameters. Okay, because you don't have independent data. Unless you want to just condition exactly on one cluster and not generalize outside of it, that's a possibility. But that's usually not what we want to do. There you go, you're just assuming structure, right? I mean, you don't have an average that you can borrow off of for a moment-based estimator anymore. There's not information on independent clusters, so the trick is to try and assume a structure as best you can. Go with it, right? I mean, those are the breaks. Okay. So Francis, I would argue that we don't really throw away data too much. You're kind of usually in one setting or the other. You're kind of in the longitudinal setting, in which case this stuff tends to work out usually in practice because, you know, just the way that sampling works for most studies. And then you're in the time series type of structure. You just kind of say, look, here is my V, and I'm sticking to it. I'm going to do a lot of hard work to think about what that V is. All right, so how about estimation here? Well, again, it's not full likelihood the way that we're looking at it. It's just an estimating function. So I don't have the concept here of an MLE on all of my parameters, in particular my alpha parameters. So we're going to do the same thing we did last time. We're going to look at moment-based estimators. And this is really, so this is what there's kind of a seminal paper by Liang and Zager back in 86, Gibbs Biometrics. Where they had introduced this approach and kind of transformed actually the way we look at certainly correlated data, to be quite honest. It's one of the more important papers in statistics as you read it. So what Liang and Zager did was they said, well, look, in a weighted least squares case, I would think about yij minus mu I half j as my residual, and I would use those residuals. They now have mu zero, and so I can get take the product of those things to get covariance estimates, right? That's what we did last time. And average over my independent clusters. The only difference that we've got now is we have a mean variance relationship, right? So I'd like to have these residuals be standardized relative to what their variance is, so they each have variance 1, so some constant variance. And so what they're doing is dividing by the square root of V hat ij, because we're thinking about the fact that each residual, its variance is going to depend upon mu ij, okay, the mean instance. So we've got these studentized or standardized residuals that we're going to think about Rij. And then it should become quite intuitive to us. And if you read the names in your paper, it's extremely intuitive. They said, look, suppose that I'm going to assume an exchangeable correlation structure. I'll just take, again, the pairwise products of each of my residuals on the ith cluster. And then I will take the average of those things. And then I'm going to average over all possible pairwise clusters, right? So if I think about the number of j not equal to k, that's going to be ni times ni minus 1. So that's the average on the ith cluster. And then you go ahead and average over all of them, okay? So the sum outside of here is accounting for the fact that I might have unequal numbers of measurements, right? Little n's on each person. And then p, what is that? Number of parameters in the mean model, you're using that to estimate the means in each case, so they're really doing that as a bias correction, right? And so they're removing off the degrees of freedom to get a better bias estimate, unbiased estimate of what that correlation estimate is, okay? Or a covariance estimate, actually, this is the covariance. Or actually, no, that's the correlation, because it's pointed by E. Okay. And if I wanted to think about an unstructured correlation model, what I would do is for alpha hat ij, again, what I'm doing is I'm allowing that thing to change now. You know what? I have a problem here. What's my problem? Structured correlation matrix, am I allowing the correlations to change across subjects or clusters? No, that's where I'm gaining the information, right? Going back to the conversation before. I'm gaining information by assuming stationarity across independent clusters, right? I'm averaging over them. So I don't want an I there, so that index should be JK, right? So this would be the JKth element of the correlation matrix. And now I'm taking the JKth residual on each cluster, and I'm going to average over all the clusters. You guys with me? So correct that for me. You guys at home are on your sheets. Okay. Right about that. Okay. Similarly, if I wanted kind of a one dependence model, so going out one space in time, then I can just simply think about summing up those alpha hat t's, where I'm now taking the pairwise, if you will. So this is just like your AR1 structure, right? So I'm moving out each one moment in time, I'm going to take the average of each of those, and then I'm going to take the average over the little n's as I sum them up. And so Bagan Zager's paper basically comes down to the same look. At the end of the day, if you use these individual correlation structures, then alpha hat is going to be a consistent estimator of alpha. What are they doing there? If they're appealing to you, we call it large numbers, right? You guys with me on that? Yeah? Consistent average. Right? So they're appealing to we call large numbers, we get consistent on alpha parameters. Okay. It turns out that statistics is horribly predictable and like super intuitive at the end of the day. I mean, it's like it comes back to like the same set of tricks over and over again, really. I think. And most of them center around taking some sum and dividing by some denominator to get a handle on the process. Okay. Good. So this particular thing, so what they have done is said, okay, if you're doing that, so that defines what we would call the GEE. So again, going through, iterating each time, and that is going to be an iterative process, right? Each time, is everybody with me on that? You can see where the iteration comes from. How do I get the R's? I get the R's by having beta hats, right? They're my residual. And each time I change my R's, I get a new alpha, which gives me a new beta hat. That's going to change the next residual. I'm going to have to iterate through that process, okay? So it's an iterative process moving through each time. Now, people call it GEE1 sometimes. You will refer to that in the literature. There is such a thing as quote-unquote GEE2. I'm not going to cover it in this class because I don't think it's super useful in practice, but that basically extends this estimating equation to a second-order moment as well. You do an estimating equation on the variance functions as well. I actually showed you that in the independent case before. The problem with that, though, is that by extending this to a second moment as you go through, you now not only have to have specified the mean model correctly, which we define that as a scientific question, but you have to specify the variance covariance correctly to get consistency on everything. And that's kind of the beauty of this, I would argue, is to get consistency of these beta hats, you don't have to specify the variance component correctly with GEE1. That's what the white gave to us. All right. So again, the iterative algorithm says, look, start off, you probably just assume an independence working correlation structure. That basically means you begin the entire process by just fitting a GLM. You call it GLM, right, inside of R. That's what this all breaks down to if you assumed an independence working correlation structure. Okay. So begin there, obtain an estimate of beta, take that estimate of beta, calculate the moment-based estimator of alpha based upon the residuals that you're getting outside of the model, and then each time add up as you're going through on those estimates. And really, it comes down to, and is actually equivalent to, and it's the precise, if you will, derivation that I gave you back in 211, this Fisher score at the end of the day. So it's equivalent to that. And again, Liang and Zager back in 86, it showed that that iterative process did exactly algorithm. Good. You guys are quiet. Is this just like crystal clear because we've seen it so many times now? Is that why? Why? Or not? Does it look familiar to you guys, everything that we're doing? Yeah? I hope so. Again, go back to 211. I showed this in the univariate case. That same, do it on this weekend when you're bored. Go ahead and recreate it in the multivariate case. Change Y to a vector, change D to a matrix, DI to a matrix, DI to a matrix. And get the same thing. Okay. Good, good, good. So now, let's talk a little bit about the properties of these things and then we'll go through an example. Okay, so again, to set the stage, you know, if you think about everything, the linear model case is very easy to think about, I would argue. And so if you think about what we did there, we went back And the golden lesson that we had seen in the general linear model setting, where you're assuming a variance covariance structure, is if you get approximately close to the true variance covariance structure, you can regain most of the efficiency. If you're very far away, though, that's not going to happen. I'll get notes in just 1 second. There we go. But if you're very far away, like you do something ridiculous, like just assume independence, and you know you've got a correlation structure, you can lose a lot of efficiency. What we saw there was you lose approximately what? In the one case that we had, it was almost 50%, right? And again, that's huge. That's like talking about throwing away data, right, friends? That's like throwing half your data away just by kind of ignoring any dependence that you have inside of your estimator. So what we want to do here is kind of explore this in the nonlinear case. And there's going to be a similar type of principle that's going to hold, but it's not going to be quite as extreme. We're not going to see those 50% reductions if we're wrong, which is kind of a good thing for us, actually. Okay. So, again, pay attention to this because your guys' homework is actually going to borrow exactly, it's going to kind of extend exactly what I'm doing here for homework problem number one. So let's think about a logistic model where we've got a binary response, and again, I've got now repeated measures in a binary response setting, right? So I'm looking at the mean for the ith cluster at the jth measurement, and I am parameterizing that mean in terms of a linear combination of my x's. Now I'm going to specifically choose two types of x's, just like I had you guys do in the continuous case, right? So I'm going to take one that is going to be time variant, right? So you think about it as a time variable that you're marching through. And then the other one is going to be cluster specific. So it'll be time invariant. So half of the clusters that I'll have are going to have x2 equal to 0, half will be x2 equal to 1. So if you want to put it in a context, you can think about it as like I treated half of my population, I didn't treat the other half of the population. You want to think about it like that. Okay. So we want to look at kind of efficiency loss or gain in both of these cases. Well, we have some theory behind this, right? So the estimation framework, again, this is exactly what I had last time. Just looks like this d mu d beta, b inverse y minus mu, plugging that guy equal to 0. We're going to make an assumption now about the correlation matrix. And in our case, if we think about the variance, okay, well, this is binary data, right? So down the diagonal, I'm going to have mu times 1 minus mu. Everybody with me on that? That's going to be the mean variance relationship on any particular observation. And then we know that asymptotically, our beta hats are going to have this particular variance form of the sandwich form, right? It's going to look like Fisher inverse, if we were correct. The sandwich of the true variance of u, estimating function, and Fisher inverse on the other side. Okay. So this is the thing that we're ultimately going to want to evaluate under different settings, okay, for an assumed variance covariance structure. And again, this is very similar to what you guys did in the linear model case. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to suppose that in truth I had an exchangeable variance covariance matrix, right? So in truth, my correlation between any two observations on the same cluster was equal to alpha. Across any of them. Okay. But I did something really naive and I just assumed that my data were independent. Okay. And I went through and I fit my model with just GLM. So we want to look at what the variance covariance is comparing the true weights when we derive an estimator to an erroneous weight using independence as we go. Okay. So to get at the truth, what we would have then, so for the variance, is if I had an independence working correlation structure, I'd be assuming that VI is equal to just the diagonal of mu times 1 minus mu for every subject, right? So that's again going right back to the good old GLM case from 211, okay, for independent data. But the true variance covariance structure of the Ys, we know, can be decomposed as a diagonal with that root mu times 1 minus mu. But then in the middle, I'll have that RI that I had before was exchangeable. Okay? Everybody with me? Right now? Yeah. All right. So, if we're lucky, we would just simply have assumed, for example, that SI, or that VI is equal to SI, the 1/2 times RI, where we correctly specify RI, and then times SI to the 1/2. The nice thing about the binary data case is this one is at least we do know, right? This goes back to your good old GLM case. You know that invariance relationship. Now, if I were talking count data, I wouldn't even necessarily know S, right? I mean, I don't know that it's truly Poisson, or it could be negative binomial, or it could be something else, right? But at least in this case, I know S. So the thing I'm really making an assumption about in practice is what R is for this correlation structure. Okay. So before we go on, again, this is something I want you guys to pay attention to on the homework as well. You've got to think about what are legal values for alpha in this case. So in other words, what are possible values for the correlation between binary random variables, okay? And I mentioned this early on in class. There's a fairly famous inequality, and I dropped, sorry, Frechet has an accent over that first E. So Frechet has a pretty famous inequality for the correlation between Bernoulli random variables, and that is given by this guy. So the correlation is bounded between this function and this function, that max and that min, okay? And I'll evaluate that for you guys in just a minute, but this is why I keep saying that the correlation A is bounded, but then also it depends upon the underlying probability of success. That's what I got here, probability of success, probability on each one of those guys, okay? And again, this is why when you see things like, way back when we think about the Beatles example, right, and how much that impacted, that correlation between those Beatles and the jars impacted the results that we had for the variance estimates. But what was the correlation? I think it was 0.09, actually. Go back, it was like 0.09, right? And so it's not something that we would generally think about for continuous data being a very large correlation, but for
Bernoulli data,
it's being large. Yeah. Okay. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through and I'm going to evaluate now. Actually, I'll just kind of walk through you guys with this. I'll just walk through the slides. I don't know if you're armed right now, so I can get to the slides in a minute. So let's set the stage here. So I'm going to choose a couple different values of beta. So I'm going to assume that the intercept is minus 2.5, and then the two quote-unquote slope parameters for x1 and x2 are 1 and 1. Okay? And again, I'm setting things up such that for my first set of folks, I've got an intercept, I've got a time-varying covariance, that's x1, and then let's play the game here, sorry, where my first half of individuals are on the control arm, for example. So they have a cluster-specific covariance of 0, or if you want to think about this as male and female. So it's not gene. So in my second set of individuals, they're only going to differ in the fact that they are now retreated. Okay. So these are just the linear predictors of these guys, right? So I'm just taking x0 times beta on each one, and then taking the x bit of each one of them to find out what the underlying probability of success is, right? So that's the probability of success for the group 0 folks, their linear predictors, and the group 1 folks. So to compute the Frechet bounds, again, all I'm doing is applying exactly the formula that I had before to figure out what legal bounds would be for these particular probabilities of success across my folks as I'm going through. Okay. So I'm walking through, my p is now just the mu that I computed from before, the q is the 1 minus mu that I had from before, and then I've just got the outer product, pp transpose and qp transpose, because I'm going to need those. And then finally, the cross products between P and Q. So if you do all of that, again, pay attention to it on your homework, you will see that the bounds now on the correlation between two observations under these probabilities are going to be about minus 0.06 to about 0.4. Okay, so like you can't go above that. Okay. Or below that. So those are the kind of the things that we want to look at in terms of assessing efficiency. Anything outside of that would be unrealistic. You know, it couldn't happen in practice. Okay. All right. Oh, my goodness. All right. So I've only given you guys the code here because You guys are gonna be able to use it if you want on the homework, right? So on the homework, all I'm having you do is, for the first part, delete some observations. You can reapply. For the second part, change the true correlation structure to an AR1 process. Okay. You can reapply. So that's why I've given you guys everything here, so you can kind of look through it and see what you've got. It's pretty standard though. All I'm doing is saying, look, here's my R. That's simply going to be my exchangeable correlation structure. My variance covariance for the zero individuals is just going to be the square root of the diagonal. That's S to the 1/2 in my notation, times R times S to the 1/2 on each one of those guys. What is D here? X times mu times 1 minus mu. So what is that D? That's just D mu D beta, right? My estimating function. Okay? So I've got D mu D beta, V, because I'm going to have V inverse in just a minute, and that's going to make up in total what my variance function is going to be. And then finally down here, I just simply have the contribution to A and B in my sandwich variance estimator, right? So the Fisher information version is going to be D transpose W, which is that working correlation matrix, times D. And then B is going to be D transpose the working assumed correlation matrix times the truth times the working correlation matrix times D, right? So in my particular case, the working correlation matrix that I'm going to assume is going to be independence, right? Times mu times 1 minus mu. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Good. So then at the end of the day, then HO and H1 are just going to be, so HO here is going to be my A inverse B, A inverse. H1 is going to be under the correct assumed correlation structure, so this whole thing is going to collapse because B0 is going to be equal to A0. I'll go together and I'll just get left with A. Okay. So once you guys run through that, you're going to see a few things. So I'm just varying rho now, the correlation, up to 0.4, because that's kind of the top of my Frechet now. And I'm starting at 0 and independence. Of course, if I've got truly independent data, then my AREs are going to be exactly the same, right? Because they're both going to collapse down. Are you guys with me? As I've assumed independence in my working correlation structure. But as that correlation starts to rise, I lose a little bit of efficiency on beta 2. What was beta 2? What type of covariate was it? Time invariant, right? Or cluster specific, you would say. Okay. So this is why, again, I keep trying to push you guys on thinking about the type of covariate you're dealing with, because the efficiency loss or gain depends upon whether it varies within a cluster or if it varies between clusters. Okay. So what you can see is if you take the asymptotic relative efficiencies, that's just the ratio of the variances again. For the beta ones, we don't even lose anything. That's not, in general, always true, and these are rounded, okay? So it is just slightly below 1, it turns out, but they're very, very close to 1, so they're rounded up. And even on beta 2, though, where it's cluster-specific, you only lose about, and thus in the most extreme case, about 3.5%. Wow. Is that surprising? It's kind of surprising when you think about the result we had in the continuous data case, right, Nina? Because you just told me that there, I lost 50% of my efficiency, right? Here, I'm losing like 3.5% into the most extreme case for kind of my correlation structures. So does that make anybody feel good? Yeah, it makes me feel kind of good, right? It says, I get pretty far wrong, and I'm really not losing that much efficiency. I feel pretty good about this. Now, it is a function of me having specified S correctly, because S is correct here, right? If I didn't specify S, this is going to start changing a lot. You guys with me on that? Okay? Because there are two things that I've got to specify. There's the mean range relationship and the correlation structure. The only thing I've misspecified here is the correlation structure. S is right. It's mu times 1 minus mu.
So count data,
count data, you want to work a little bit to try and get a correct mu. And again, you guys have looked at it for count data. I think it was homework number, like, which homework number was that? 3 or 2 or something like that, right? It was a 1? Okay. And 1, you guys looked at a negative binomial model and said, what if I assume a Poisson model? How much efficiency do I lose? So, and you need, and there, that same principle will hold. But at least there's a little bit of solace in the magnitudes of efficiency loss for being wrong in the correlation structure, and binary data probably aren't that great. It turns out there is a very, very good paper on this. So Fitzmaurice back in 95 has a paper where basically everything is gone through piece by piece and much more kind of detailed than what I've got here. So I would encourage you guys to read it. And the nice thing is, and this is just a summary of what I talked about before, but when you read through the Fitzmaurice paper, actually, and if I like the quote at the end of the day, the quote at the end of the day is, look, some attempts should generally be made to model the association between the responses in order to gain, you know, efficiency, even if you're going to treat them as a nuisance. And that's, you know, really, again, you know, my goal oftentimes is to think about beta. I'm only trying to estimate the variance covariance to deal with efficiency, right? And so, again, this is kind of a take-home guiding principle is do some EDA to think about something reasonable, even if it's a nuisance. But as you get to the discrete data setting, it has less and less of an impact, actually. So kind of nice. Now, here's the one thing about simulation, though. This is all under one particular structure, right? I've got these underlying betas that I've assumed to be the truth. That gives rise to the underlying mu's that I've assumed to be the truth. I've only got 2 covariates in the model. One is time varying, one is cluster specific. Okay. So simulation does not generalize very easily, right? And so don't take everything that you see here and say, oh, the maximum I'll ever lose is 3.5% efficiency. No, that's not true. You can break it more than that. But what I'm trying to do is give you a snapshot of saying it's not nearly as extreme as what we had in the continuous data case. Okay. So if you're bored and you want to do extra things on the homework, try varying the parameters of the model and try putting some time varying covariates in there as well, like additional ones, and see what happens. Okay. See if you can bring the efficiency down even more than what you're seeing here. Okay. But in general, again, the take-home message for you guys should be that the losses aren't nearly as much as in the continuous data case. Good? Yeah. Are you guys getting kind of this general principle of like how we evaluate things in statistics? I hope that you are getting that through the classes, right? I mean, so what is the kind of, like, when we think about developing methodology in statistics, a lot of you guys in here are going to be developing methodology, or at least assessing it. So you start by saying, look, let me obtain some estimator. It's going to come from different maybe forms, right? It might be an estimating equation, it might be maximum likelihood, it might be a Bayes estimator. You guys with me on this? So now I have an estimator. And then you start by saying, okay, what do you want to show about that estimator first? Consistency, usually, right? You want to say, as my sample size starts to grow, do I start converging on the correct thing? Right? I mean, that's kind of a reasonable place to start. And then after that, you start to sit back and you say, okay, and then what's the, what's that? Correct inference. In order to get a correct inference, you need to know the true variance, and that usually leads you to efficiency, right? You start thinking about efficiency of those estimators, right? So given 2 estimators that are consistent, we would like to have the one that's more efficient, right? Has a smaller true variance, okay? And then from there, then we start to think about incorrect inference, right? So now how can I estimate that true variance in practice? I mean, it's like the classic framework as you go through statistics, okay? Now, some things become a little bit easier. Like if you're coming at this from a Bayes perspective, well, guess what? Estimating the variance, it's right from the posterior, right? If you're able to draw from the posterior, it's all sitting there for you. Now, that posterior, though, is conditional upon what? Yeah. Well, and likelihood, right? I mean, it's a function of the likelihood and the prior. Now, the correct prior, I don't know exactly what that means, it's subjective by nature. But it's dependent, it's conditional upon the prior that you've chosen, as well as specifying the likelihood per liter of the bottle. Okay, so I mean, there's no free lunch there. It comes out nicely in the sense that, yeah, I can just take my posterior draws and I don't have to worry about a sandwich variance estimator anymore, but realize that those posterior draws are conditional upon the things you wrote down to obtain that posterior distribution. Okay. Yes.
What about bias? Do you care about that right after consistency? Or can we still be direct concerns if you have a bias?
Yeah, so in general, so consistency first. If you're a frequentist, I would argue that bias does become important because it is a frequentist operating characteristic, right? I mean, bias inherently is a frequentist operating characteristic. It says, on average, if I do this over and over again and obtain a theta hat, on average, those theta hats will equal to the true value of theta. Well, that's over-repeated experimentation, right? That's frequentist. Okay. So many of us, and I do care about bias, because it turns out that small sample properties can vary a lot relative to large sample properties, right? You think about consistency, that's a large sample property. It says, am I converging on this thing as I go off to infinity? So yes, I do tend to think about bias as well when I'm coming in there for small samples.
Can you make direct inference if you have bias estimators?
Non-finite samples, right? I mean, so if you think about it, if I've got large bias in my estimator and I think about the coverage probability, for example, the confidence interval, well, it's going to be centered at wherever that estimator is, right?
So if we have like the lasso regression or something, can we just like not make any inference off of this?
Well, that's interesting. So with lasso, so what are you going to be trying to make inference on?
The regression parameters.
Really? What do they mean?
The same thing, but it's like biased now.
Lasso. I haven't actually talked about it, so it's kind of unfair for me to talk about. Does everybody know what lasso is? So lasso, think about a linear regression model where you penalize, basically, a linear regression model. So you force the magnitude of all the variables to come down, the coefficients to come down. So the reason why I'm saying this, Stephen, is because once I put that penalization on, I have no idea what each of those coefficients means now. So we usually don't talk about putting confidence intervals on it. Yeah, I mean, it's like, there's no real interpretation to them because I've put this very odd structure on the rest of the model to force everything to come down. So really,
just for prediction.
Yeah, and lasso has been basically for prediction. It's a penalization method to try and regularize. So, yeah. And if you get into a lasso setting, I mean, that is kind of a problem that people, they sometimes try and interpret those things. It's like, put so many constraints on the model. Okay, good. So again, the things that I've been kind of running through with you guys from 2.11 up until now, it's classic strategy in how you develop and then evaluate estimators and statistics. It comes up over and over again. Okay, so now let's think about applying these things though. So I'm going to introduce a study called the MADRS longitudinal study. So for you guys that are reading Diggle, Liang, Hagerty, and Zager. That's the book for this class, if you haven't forgotten already. They introduced the MADRS example in there as well, so I pulled it from them. So the MADRS example was a longitudinal study where it was patients that were admitted for schizophrenia. And the idea was to determine a couple of things, but really the idea was to determine how quickly patients recover from schizophrenic episodes, okay, as they go through, and to determine if those recovery rates were different in this particular case by gender and by age, okay? And so the way you would think about, or one way that people sometimes will think about schizophrenic episodes is they'll think about the number of occurrences of quote-unquote thought disorders, right? And these are self-reported by the patients as you go through. So what we've got is each month after somebody gets hospitalized for schizophrenia, and it's their first hospitalization, that's the initial aspect of this, each month they would go and they would talk to the psychiatrist for the patient. They would say, did the patient have a thought disorder or not? So it's binary. It's one or it's a zero for that month, okay, as you're going through. So discrete data as we're moving along. And again, part of the question here was to say, okay, are the rates of recovery, in other words, is the probability of having a thought disorder as time is moving along changing depending upon whether somebody is young versus old? And here I'm going to define somebody as young versus old as less than 20 or older than 20.
Okay.
And then male versus female. Okay, so are males or females tending to recover quicker? In other words, their probability of having a thought disorder is going down quicker in time after their initial hospitalization. Okay, so the primary outcome again is a binary indicator. So we're going to be thinking kind of GEE in this case, and we'll extend that to a GLMM in the next lecture. Okay. So I'm going to jump over into R now, and we'll walk through this a little bit. So same principle is going to hold that I had done before, in that I want to describe the data. I'll give some general summary measures for you guys. Then I'm going to kind of go into EEA for the variance covariance matrix. Okay. So we'll make this data set pretty simple. I'm going to reduce it down to just kind of the primary things. Again, if I were coming at this in practice, I'd be thinking about confounding, right, as I go through doing all of the thought process that we have dealt with in the past. But right now, I'm just going to think about response, time, these are the months since hospitalization, age, and then gender. And so age is just going to be greater than 20, less than 20. Okay, so it's an indicator. Gender again is going to be female versus male, zero being male. Okay. And then of course I've got an ID variable that says how is the clustering occurring inside of my data. Okay. So this person's having thought disorders, thought disorders, thought disorders, thought disorders, thought disorders, and none at 6 months, or at 5 months out. Okay. Okay. Good. Everybody okay on the structure of the data here? All right. So a couple of things. Again, if you're in kind of a repeated measures data setting, one of the first things you want to do is say, how many measurements do I have on each one of my clusters, right? So 69 of my subjects here, I've got 12 measurements on, so it's fairly complete data in that case. One subject I've got only 11 measurements on, two I've got 10 months of measurements on, etc. There are a few folks down here, three in particular, that have either two measurements or one measurement. And again, the scientific question here is relative to a rate of change, right? It's who's declining faster or slower. Yeah, so I'm talking about estimating a slope, okay, on the probability. So these guys aren't going to give you very much information there. It's a slope on 1 point or slope on 2 points. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and drop the individuals that have less than three measurements. Again, I'm usually not a big fan of just like eliminating data, but my whole point of this is to assess a trend over time. People that are only giving me one or two measurements aren't giving me information on the trend. Okay. So we'll pull them off. And then I'm just going to create a couple of tables, female, male, and then young, old, just to see exactly what type of data that I have. Okay, so these are just sample sizes now. So I'm just tabling age by gender. So age on the column, or on the rows, and gender on the columns. So I've got 31 individuals that are of young age, less than 20, and male, 23 individuals that are less than 20 and female. Okay, so I'm just giving a breakdown of the four groups that I'm really interested in here. So that's at baseline. One of the things I would probably do if I were doing this analysis is take OSWAT a year out, right? And so I'd look at what the sample sizes are a year out. Why might I be doing such a thing? What am I looking for when I do this at baseline and then I do it at a year out?
Basically differential sort of like dropout.
Exactly. What does that tell me? Why do I care about that dropout, whether it varies by male, female, young, old? Because I'm thinking about MAR types of settings, right? I'm saying, is there missing data? Is the missing data dependent upon covariates inside of mine that I've observed? Okay. so I can at least determine that. So there is a little bit of an imbalance here. You see that young folks are actually dropping a little bit faster out of the study. They're not coming back as much as older folks actually take just the marginals on those totals that are sitting over here, right? So that's one of the things that we're actually seeing inside of our data. So there, if you're gonna again think about dropout, there's not a ton of dropout, I would argue, in this study, but of the little bit that there is, it definitely has a bit of an association. So you could go a little bit fancier with this, these are just simple descriptives, but you could just model the probability of dropping out, right? That's actually what you guys did in your final for 211. Remember that? A long time ago. You guys modeled whether patients completed a study depending upon the study partner type. So there you were actually investigating who would actually have missing data or not. You could do a similar type of thing here, changing your outcome to completing versus not completing. Okay. So again, sticking to the scientific question, one of the other things I might want to do is I might want to plot what the prevalence of symptoms are as patients are moving along through time across the groups, right? And so I'm going to let you guys read through the code here, but all I'm doing is getting prevalence estimates, simple proportion estimates at each time, and then I'm going to plot those out. And I'm doing it for each possible group that I have for the four groups, and so I'll just show you what that is going to come out to be. So once you guys go through the code, what you're going to see is I got, again, old versus old and male, young and male, etc. These are just line plots here where I've computed the empirical proportion of schizophrenic events or symptomatic events at each one of these times as folks have left the hospital. So a couple of things that you have here, right? What is the first thing that you notice? Well, I would say even before you start getting into subpopulations, like subgroups, yeah, symptoms are declining over time, right? I mean, as folks are going farther and farther out from their initial hospitalization, their probability of having symptoms are decreasing, right? So if you think about the trajectory of the odds of symptoms, it should be going down, it should be negative, right? Just marginal over the entire population. Now, yes, this large dotted or dashed line in blue here, those are individuals that are over 20 and female, they tend to decrease faster, right? So they're experiencing a more rapid, if you will, decline coming down. Okay, so there's the symptomatology. So the underlying goal here is to say, are the rates differing between male and female, or are the rates differing between young and old, okay, as we go through? And so this plot is fairly informative for folks to be able to show them. Is it a cross-sectional plot or is it a longitudinal? Did we get a cross-sectional effect or longitudinal? It's cross-sectional, right? I mean, what I'm doing is I'm saying at month two, if I take everybody there and I average across all of those people, what proportion of them are having symptoms? That's totally cross-sectional, right? It's not saying anything about Sally and what her odds are as she's going across time, okay? In order to do that, what would you have to do? How do we deal with the longitudinal effect in the continuous data case? Spaghetti plots, are they gonna be very useful here? Say no. They're gonna go zero or one, zero or one, or zero or one. It's very hard to visualize a within subject effect when you've got discrete data, okay? So that sparseness coming back in, okay? You're kind of stuck to some degree with the cross-sectional plot. Okay. Good. Other things that you might want to include on here if you could. I think it would make it a very busy plot, but what if I not have on here? This is not in any way, shape, or form a perfect plot, and it's not the one that I would produce for if I were writing a report or if I were doing a publication. It would be the general structure of this, but I'd add a lot of things to it.
Yeah, you guys are statisticians, right? I mean, precision, right, Ernie? What do you know about precision? These are point estimates, right? I mean,
we know that there are actually, in fact, 69 individuals that are out over here. We've already seen that, okay? But just looking at this plot, I wouldn't know that. I mean, it could be that this is based upon, this one is based upon 3 people, and this one is based upon 69 people. I mean, I wouldn't know it either way. So maybe what you would add down here on the bottom of this is for each one of the 4 groups, what is the sample size at each time, right? That would be pretty useful. And after being inside of there. If you were really fancy, although I can't really figure out a good way to do it without confusing the plot too much, you might want to try to put error bars or something like that on here, right? You might do color shading to show overlapping where the error bars are. But again, I think it would make the plot very, very busy and hard to read. Okay, so I would probably just go with sample size down at the bottom and give some aspect of precision of what I'm having to do. Okay? Okay. Good. So again, I mean, when you guys think about plotting things, think about all the information you as a reader would like to see, right? If you were to just look at this, and play devil's advocate, think about how it could be misleading, right, if you don't give that information. Again, if some of these things, I've only got a couple of observations, well, the reader, the eye, just treats them all equally, right? Unless you're telling me that I've only got a couple of observations that are sitting there. So that's it's absolutely critical to try and convey that information as you go through.
Can we get error bars?
How would you get error bars? I mean, take 10-2. So that point estimate there is literally a sum of counts, yeses and nos, divided by a denominator. It's Bernoulli, right? Yeah, so its variance is going to be p hat times 1 minus p hat divided by n, however many people I have there. And I will approximate p hat, its distribution with, most likely, a normal. Because it's a mean, right? So that's a good old one sample binomial portion. Yeah. Okay. So I'd probably put confidence intervals on these at my point, rather than just errors. If I were willing to do it. But again, I think that would be very difficult in this setting because you get a lot of overlap of these, right? If you start picturing putting them on here, like the eye is going to go on.
Sample size isn't very large. We can't use the.
Oh, yeah. So that's the pop quiz for everybody. Okay, so now suppose that I've only got 9 observations in each group, and I want to put the confidence interval on p hat. So Nina's saying, look, I don't want to build a central limit theorem because my intro textbook told me that it had to be n equals to 25 or more. And yeah, that's kind of not bad either. But 9, you are getting to where you're getting very unstable in terms of that approximation from the normal on that mean. Okay. So what are you going to do? You guys are at the third quarter of a very, very rigorous class. Now, this is a one sample binomial problem, small sample sizes. What would you do for a confidence interval? What's the distribution of any one of those elements in the numerator that I just summed over? They're ones or zeros, right? Symptom or not? Are they independent? At any one time? At any one time?
Yeah.
Yeah. They're across different people, right? I've got independent zeros and ones. What is their distribution? Each individual one is Bernoulli when I sum them all up. Binomial. I'm estimating a common P, right? A common probability of success for that binomial. How might you get a confidence interval for that if you're in small sample sizes?
You know the distribution.
Yeah, the exact binomial confidence interval, right? I mean, you can literally go and table up and determine what those confidence intervals are, right? The binomial distribution, the exact binomial. How many people have computed an exact binomial confidence interval? Myself. Do that. It's very important to be able to do these things. No, honestly, I mean, you're not always going to be able to rely upon the central limit theorem. There are sometimes when it, and this is one of the beautiful cases where you know what the distribution is, right? You know it's binomial. You can literally go and look up a binomial distribution and determine exactly what the confidence bounds are on that probability of success.
Thank you.
It's a good question, you know. I mean, it's something that we have to deal with, right? I mean, it's like we tend to forget about it because it was like, oh, I think we looked at that back in Statistics 101, right? I mean, way back in the day. But that it comes up again, and we've always got to be thinking about how to do it.
I thought it was something fancier, but I don't know why.
Yeah, no, don't fit any models to it. Don't fit any models to it. Don't do anything like that. It just turns out that it's binary. Infinite for noise, taking the sum of them. Okay. So we're going to come back next time, and I'll let you guys go from now, but basically, one of the things I wanted to point out, and we'll do this next time, is I'm going to move to EDA for the co-brain structure. Now EDA for the co-brain structure is going to be a little bit more difficult, right, because you've got sparse code, zeros and ones. It's not like our good old continuous database. So, one of the things... that we'll have to do is just think on a slightly different scale. So, for example, I quoted this to you guys last time. To try and assess whether we've got dependence in the data, we might look at something, very cute name, like the Lorelogram, so that's log-Oz ratiogram. Okay, and so what this is doing, and I'll again show you guys next time, but as I start thinking about within the subject, what is the odds ratio for my baseline measurement if I were to try and predict out to 6 months, for example? Or my baseline measurement if I were to predict out to 11 months? If there was no association, if there was pure independence, this line would look flat at zero, right? It would say that my baseline doesn't dictate whatever my probability of symptoms are going to be, you know, 6 months down the road or 11 months down the road. But you can see here, that no, at the time of discharge, you're highly predictive at 1 month out, right? The log odds ratio is somewhere around 3.5. And that log odds ratio, even at 11 months out though, it's declining, but that's still about 0.6, and so that's about an odds ratio of around 2, right? 1.75 or so. And so there's still predictive ability, right, of your baseline symptoms all the way out to 12 months. But you can see that it is declining, so what type of correlation structure might we start to assume here?
AR.
Yeah, kind of like AR, right? If it were exchangeable, what would we see? Roughly flat, right, and not at zero, right? So some correlation is not dissipating as a function of time. This is something that where we see correlation that is dissipating as time, but the way we're measuring quote-unquote correlation is here is just the odds ratio for predicting out. Because we've got to kind of change scales, because we can't really estimate correlation anymore very well. Okay, so we'll pick that up next time.